We are going to get started here today. I'd like to welcome you all to Cyber Data Attacks, Are Farmers and Agribusinesses Exempt? This is going to be a really interesting discussion, I think, and there's a lot to be learned here from our panelists as well. I would like to welcome you on behalf of our partners, AgriGrowth and member companies Baker Tilly, Dorsey and Whitney, and Lockton Companies are partnering on this event to bring together experts from within our membership to benefit other people within the AgriGrowth membership. And so we're really grateful to them for participating and all the time that they've put into this. And I'd like to thank a couple of our panel planning participants. They've put in a lot of work to making sure that this is a high-quality program. From Baker Tilly, Christy Lines, who's, if you want to raise your hand there in the back, and Mark Keeker, who is not yet arrived. From Dorsey Whitney, Jane Wilgus, and from Lockton Companies, Ole Hovde and Joe Haskins. So thank you for all your time in this. We'd like to welcome those of you who are on the phone joining us today. We're going to start out with a brief overview of AgriGrowth, and then we're going to move into each of our panelists is going to share some context with us about their perspective on cyber data security. And we're going to do Q&A throughout the entire presentation. I will also be announcing New York CLE code later in the program for those of you from New York who are joining us. And we've applied for CLE authorization from Iowa, Minnesota, North Dakota, Oregon, Utah, Washington, and Colorado. If you are in a state that is that we have not applied for, please let us know and we will apply for it in your area as well. So for those of you in the room, if you do want CLE credit, please complete the green form in the center of your table and we'll collect those at the end. For those of you joining us by phone, a sign-in sheet was attached to your email, your reminder email this week, and complete that and send it back and then we'll turn those in for you as well. So a little bit about AgriGrowth. Now, most everyone who registered for this session is a member of AgriGrowth already, but some of you didn't know you were members of AgriGrowth already, so it might seem weird that I'm giving an overview about AgriGrowth to our own members, but I'm going to catch you all up to speed in case you didn't know that. AgriGrowth is a nonprofit, nonpartisan trade association, and we've been representing food systems and agriculture for the industry for nearly 50 years. 2018 will be our 50th anniversary celebration. The reason the work AgriGrowth does is so important because if we fail on food, we fail on everything. And as you can see on the slide, there's some of the statistics about Minnesota's place in the world in terms of our production levels, employees, economic impact in the state of Minnesota, and it's a really significant piece of our sector, and if we don't eat, everything else goes away. So Minnesota, agriculture is the second largest economic driver in the state. It's something we certainly have to pay attention to, and AgriGrowth is a great advocate for making sure that we make this a positive business climate. Our vision that our board set is to serve as a convener, an advocate, and a thought leader by creating common ground solutions which move the food and agriculture industry forward. Meetings like today are a part of that. The more we get together and discuss topics together, the more innovation comes, the more we partner together and can solve problems in more proactive ways. There are three strategic priorities which guide AgriGrowth's work: advocating for a positive business climate for Minnesota's food systems and agriculture, building awareness and trust and support for our sector with key influencers, as well as consumers, serving as a convener and a thought leader on issues relevant to the future growth and prosperity of our sector. We have over 170 member organizations, with over 600 professional contacts within those organizations. We largely focus on Minnesota, but we also do some federal advocacy work as well. We're a small staff, so we don't have the staff to be in DC, but we do engage and have very strong relationships with our congressional delegation. To tell you just a little bit about our membership base, and I might need to get my readers out for this one, 27.5% of our membership base is in the agribusiness category. Now, there are many levels within that, such as manufacturing and food processing, and some of our companies actually would fit across 5 or 6 different industry sectors. So that is our largest group within our membership. 21% are associations and nonprofits, 15% are farmers, 12% are LLCs and individuals. Many of the LLCs are consultants and work with a number of our member companies. 5% legal and financial, 5% academic and government, 4.5% public affairs, communications and marketing, 3% in transportation, 3% in ag lending, 2% in engineering, and 2% in energy. So we have a broad spectrum of the industry represented within our membership base. 66% of AgriGrowth members have been committed to our mission for over 10 years. That's as far back as our data goes. One of our members says, I had the opportunity to talk directly with Minnesota's Speaker of the House for 15 minutes at an AgriGrowth event. How else would I get that opportunity? The value for our members is different depending on what your business needs are, but that is one of the value propositions for some of our members. In my conversations with our members on a regular basis, some themes have emerged as to why people think their membership in AgriGrowth is valuable. They say we having a trusted and credible organization dedicated to advocating for and managing the policy environment allows members to focus on operating their businesses and knowing that those aspects are still covered for them. Cross-sector networking opportunities were one of our unique roles as a trade association is that we are the only trade association in Minnesota that has that cross-sector representation versus single sector. We stay informed about trends, threats, and opportunities within the industry, and we provide up-to-date industry news and information and opportunities to collaborate and partner, today being one example of that. Just to scan over some of our coalitions and collaboratives, and I won't go into explaining them all, but the Minnesota Business Immigration Coalition, Real-Time Talent Workforce Initiative, and we have a board seat on that initiative. Enterprise Minnesota, we're a sponsor of their State of Manufacturing report. Center for Food Integrity, which is a consumer research organization. WCCO, Business by Carlson, a radio broadcast talking about the agriculture sector in Minnesota. Agree, AgriGrowth Working Lands Conservation Pilot Project, doing some work on proactive work on water issues in Minnesota. A Greater Minnesota Coalition, Ag Food Alliance, and Minnesota Ag PAC. I'm not going to read through the list of our member engagement opportunities. You can see them all on the PowerPoint there. Sorry, I can't do two things at once. I'm not following the screen. There we go. You can see them all on the PowerPoint, so I won't define them. I will talk specifically about one, which is our annual meeting coming up on November 10th, and that will be held at St. Paul River Center. For those in the room, I do have some postcards with information about that, but I've given the full agenda in your PowerPoint so you can see who's coming, and if you have additional questions, I'd be happy to talk with you about the annual meeting and conference. I will say at that conference, we tend to focus our efforts on macro level topics that sort of have tentacles that reach over the entire industry. Some examples of that are water, sustainability, workforce, talent retention and recruitment, those types of issues that impact across our membership. So just to sum up some of the challenges that are facing the industry, we've been around nearly 50 years and the list of challenges are not getting smaller, but we have a very strong and powerful engagement with our members who are problem solvers and innovators and really want to find sound solutions that support the industry and help the world around them as well. So I will just, before I introduce our panelists, I do want to introduce our Executive Director, Perry Osnes, who is here. He's going to have to slip out early, but for those in the room, if you want to just wave Perry so you can, in case you haven't met him yet, I just want to make sure that you have the opportunity to do that. Before I introduce our panelists, I want to talk just very briefly about this topic. This came to be through my discussions with our members, and as some of our members are asking, how can we partner with AgriGrowth? How can we share our expertise? How can we help the people within your membership on a variety of topic areas? And this topic of cybersecurity continued to come up, and it's something that the three firms here are seeing increasing in prevalence. So as we mulled through that and started to see, cybersecurity is kind of like insurance. Like, you don't want to talk about it. It's not a fun subject or retirement planning, but if you didn't do it, you're sure sorry you didn't have that conversation. So we're hoping we can excite people a little bit about this topic and help them understand the importance of it and that there are options if you want to do something about it. So also, we want this to be a very interactive event. We do not want this to be suits talking to tables. We want interaction, questions. Let's have some dialogue. I think that's where we learn the most and we can glean the most from our experts when they can talk about real life situations and answer real questions. So I encourage you, if you're in the room, to raise your hand and at any time during the entire program. We don't need to save questions until the end, so please feel free to either raise your hand or there are question cards on the table. You can complete those and just kind of hold it up, and Jane or Christy will grab that from you and bring it up to me. So either way, we welcome your interaction. If you're joining us on the phone, there is a chat box in the top right-hand corner of your screen. Please enter your questions at any time, and they'll get those to me up front, and we'll interject those as appropriate as well. So we set this up in rounds and not classroom style for a reason, because we want this to be very interactive. So I'm going to introduce our three speakers, and then they're going to move into their presentations from there. So I'll just introduce them all up front. Our first presenter is Robert Kedenek, and he is with Dorsey and Whitney. He's with Dorsey and Whitney. And I'll just read his quick bio here. He helps clients navigate the complexities of regulatory law, especially in the area of cybersecurity and compliance. And he provides the perspective and skills of a seasoned trial lawyer to protect their interests in the courtroom. His technical background enables him to understand the complex business challenges associated with today's cyber world and provide the strategic acumen to achieve success. So thank you, Bob, for sharing your time and expertise with us today. Following Bob will be Al Sweeney. He is a director at Baker Tilly. Al has been with Baker Tilly since 2016, and he's a cybersecurity and privacy leader with a consistent 17-year history of delivering, managing, and supporting large and complex projects. So we would like to thank you for joining Baker Tilly and us today. And our final panelist is Madeline Allen. She is with an account executive with Lochton Companies. As an account executive for Lochton Companies in Kansas City, Madeline provides expertise in the areas of data security, privacy liability, media, and specialty errors and omissions insurance. She is a member of Lochton's cyber technology practice, and she joined Lochton in 2013. And we thank her for, she gets the award for traveling the farthest distance with us today. So thank you, Madeline. So with that, I am going to turn it over to Robert, and let's get started.
Thank you, and good morning. It's an exciting time when you think about the explosion of data in the ag sector. It's just amazing. Al's going to talk a little bit more about some of the specific areas, but the amount of data being generated right now in the ag sector, whatever slice of the ag sector you want to look at, is expanding geometrically. And with it come great potential for improvements and efficiencies and economies, and just the whole management of the ag sector. But those, in turn, carry with them the risk that that data is going to be interfered with by any number of different threat actors for any number of different reasons. So the good news is there's great things happening in the ag sector because of data. The bad news is that there are more parts of the ag sector that are at risk. Director Mueller said there's only two types of companies. It's been hacked, and those that will be, and those are converging. So I'm going to depart a little bit from the slide script to just note a couple of things of context. Yes, there are vectors where it's no longer just crimes of opportunity. There are dedicated people out there that are organized, that are trying to get data. And it takes maybe just a minute or two to contemplate, well, why, what would they want? First of all, if you think about the intrinsic value of ag data right now to people who might have access to it for its intellectual value. So there's so much data being generated about crop production, the success and tuning of different seeds, herbicides, pesticides. All that data is being generated and tracked by some pipeline, but then also being shared. Some of you may know of, and here's where I'll depart a little bit, of the privacy and security principles for farm data. As of March 3rd of 2016, there were 37 signers, many of them you will recognize, such as Dow AgroSciences, DuPont, John Deere, and then the growers' associations of soybeans, wheat, barley, corn, cotton, sorghum. Syngenta's a signer. So I mention that because some of the principles will apply to everyone in this room, either directly or derivatively. And permit me, if you will, just a moment to read, I think, one of the most important ones. It states, ownership. We believe farmers own information generated on their farming operations, so the farmer should own that operation. However, it is the responsibility of the farmer to agree upon data use and sharing with the other stakeholders with an economic interest, such as the tenant, landowner, cooperative, owner of the precision agricultural system hardware, etc. So I saw, I think this week, a picture, could have been in the New York Times, of what was claimed to be the first driverless tractor. No steering wheel, no seat. It otherwise looked like a tractor. Now imagine, all the data we know already is out there, and it's just gonna continue to evolve. With it comes great opportunity, but also some risk. Organized crime will look for ways to profit from that data. And then there's just the mere potential for disruption. In some of the larger companies, you've already seen some of these scams where through social engineering, what appears to be a request from the CEO or CFO, we need to wire $10 million or $10,000 or any number in between right away, please do this. And poor people that have fallen for this, that money's gone. Here's one that I would suggest, not that we're here to scare anybody, but you just look at the ransomware potential here. There is in the agriculture sector now a great interaction on the Internet of Things. Some of you may have seen last Friday that was hacked, brought the Internet down itself. to a crawl. So the bad guys are in with the ability to disrupt the Internet of Things. Where, and this is going back now to the targets of opportunity. So imagine any of your companies or any individual farmer out there who, and these are small sometimes threats. They say, we've locked everything up. We've locked it. We've penetrated your systems. You can't use the data that's being generated. Your hard drive, your server is locked down. Pay us. Sometimes it's as cheap as $500 for individuals. Other times it's $50,000. And even if you have your data backed up, just the mere inconvenience. So, again, there are people out there that get up in the morning in Eastern Europe and get their cup of coffee and, where do I go today? Where am I going to make my money today? And they're going to look for targets of opportunity. And the ag sector is an increasingly low-hanging fruit for those people. So what do you do? Oh, here's a quick the slide for the cost of the consequences of a data breach. But this is very simple, very straightforward, but it requires some discipline. And I think whether you're, no matter where on the food chain you may be, you have to know your data and where it resides. Know what you're collecting. Vendor management, and vendor, that can mean partner as well. The ag sector is very interdependent in how it exchanges data up and down. And know who's getting that data and what are they doing to protect it. My sense is, having dealt some with the ag sector, that it is lagging a little bit from other sectors in how proactive and sophisticated the business relationships are. Is it spelled out between two business partners? Who's responsible for the protection of the data that they exchange? What if something goes wrong? Who's going to fix it? Who's going to step up for the potential damages or consequences? So the very biggest two things I could leave you with today is, know what your data is in the sense of having information governance. Write it down. Who's got ownership of this data? Who's responsible for protecting it? And then have an incident response plan and practice it, and you're going to hear more about cyber insurance. Information governance is a pretty sleepy topic, sorry, but it's so essential. You got to know who's collecting it, where is it being stored, who's retaining it, why. These are just basic, blocking and tackling of information governance. But when you come to grips with the data that you have, here's what we have. You have to decide, what's our appetite for risk? What are we going to do to protect that data? How do we categorize that data? Do we care if anybody gets it? Is it the crown jewels? And that the steps you take to protect that data will be then driven by the importance of that data. And you can't protect everything. It's impossible. So you have to assume that some level of protection will be given to some of the data that you would prefer remain confidential, but a different level of protection will have to be given to the crown jewels. What we are seeing in many other sectors, driven principally by the financial sector, followed by the health sector and the energy sector, but it's going to go to all areas of business, is the documentation of your information governance and data protection process. Last week, the FDIC and the Federal Reserve announced that they will require all major financial institutions to have their board of directors certify that they are what their data protection levels are, that they've been briefed on it, that their chief information security officer has a plan. Now, that's not yet come to the agricultural sector, but it will. I absolutely guarantee, as we see, and we've seen it throughout the evolution of data protection, data governance, it will start in the financial sector. It'll go quickly from there to health and energy, and then it goes to the rest of the sectors of the U.S. economy. And we haven't even talked about Europe. Vendor management, I couldn't overstress the importance of that. When you see vendor, it may be somebody you hire, somebody that hires you, or just business partners. IT vendors are probably the biggest source of in the ag sector. A lot is contracted out, although there's also professional service providers, independent contractors, and temps. Your security for your data is only as good as the weakest link. And I would suggest that 90 plus times out of 100, the weakest link is in the vendor chain. What we're seeing, again, starting with the financial sector, third-party vendor risk management, not only are companies being called upon to demonstrate their own compliance, but that their vendors comply with basic data security measures. It's tough to demand some of these protections if you're in the middle of a relationship with a vendor or business partner. So as you move forward, it's really helpful to look at their security measures before you retain them, and things as simple as, you know, what kind of onboarding and offboarding do they have for their staff? So that, what kind of training do they have? Do they even know where their data is located? Do they encrypt? Do they have any penetration testing? And who certifies their security? Increasing, what we're seeing is that people who have entrusted their data to vendors will personally take site visits and audits of those vendors' facilities to see exactly how good their security systems are. So the contractual requirements with vendors are also very important. Legally, it's difficult to bring a discipline over this process because typically we see that the contractual relationships are all over the map. But if you can find some way to standardize them, and the biggest issue is going to be at the end of the day when you deal with a business partner or vendor, if something goes wrong, who's going to step up and take responsibility for that, both from an operational standpoint as well as if there are damages from an indemnification standpoint. We were going to hear more about cyber insurance in a bit, but that's I will preview for you. When you see an imbalance between a vendor and its customer, and the vendor says, my contract with you is only worth $100,000. I'm not going to indemnify you up to $10 million for this contract. It's just not worth it. I think the real promise of cyber insurance in this market is it can bridge that gap. They're getting more and more innovative in the cyber insurance market. We're going to hear about that. But I think when you do have that imbalance and that difference in risk appetite, there are ways to address that as you deal with your vendors. I'm not going to spend a lot of time in the incident response plan, but it is hugely important. It's a big part of what I do. I get very too often frequent calls about clients of ours that have been breached, and you have to parachute in, and it's a real fire drill, and it's a very, very challenging situation. If you can get an incident response plan instituted in your organizations, it makes all the difference in the world. And as you may know, increasingly other sectors are demanding that the institutions in those sectors certify that they have an incident response plan. So this is just an example of who might be on that plan or a part of that team. I won't spend, again, a lot of time on this, but I leave it to you in the slide deck there, because this is a critical part. You can't just have a team and then leave that document on a server someplace or in a desk drawer and never use it. What we've seen very successfully in some of the companies that I'm fortunate enough to do business with is when they do get hacked, and they get hacked, if they've got a good plan, they're on it. And they can respond within minutes. And we do our best to respond, frankly, within hours. We have a very rapid response team here that can help in those situations. But on the ground, it has to be the company's incident response plan itself. So as many, yeah.
How about
Sure. The question for the webinar was only asked how much time would it take to develop an incident response plan, and then do a tabletop exercise. Thank you for asking that question because it's a great question. What we have template response plans that we use as the building block with our clients. But what we have found is the best incident response plan is the one that is developed organically within the client, because then you have ownership. You can have IT put together an incident response plan within a matter of a month or less. You have to kind of understand where the data is, where it flows, and they can you can put together a team from that. But a better answer to your question is, and in my personal experience, let's say you go back tonight and you have a discussion with someone that we need an incident response plan. From that moment, probably 6 months, because what you need to do is engage the various functional areas of the company. Let me go back here, because here's when you develop that plan. This is part of the team, right, that will execute that plan. I'm really glad you asked that question, because I left this out. So the plan should be developed by the people that are on the team, not by IT, who usually gets stuck, sounds pejorative, but with putting the plan together. What you want are the people that really are going to have to do this, get in a room and say, how are we going to do this? And it doesn't have to be executive vice president levels. It can be managers. It can be directors. But you want IT. You want the information security. You're going to want your risk management folk. You're going to want legal. You're going to want HR. I don't know why they're not on there. Sorry. Public relations. So you get those people in a room, and you say, what are we going to do? And you will start with a template, because we have them. We'd be happy to share with them. But then from that template, you have to tailor it to the needs of your organization. So let's say you start today. You get these people in a room. It's gonna take months. It's not days. It's more than weeks. What's the priority? If the CEO wants it, it'll be done very quickly. But if it's just sort of organically happening, it'll take a few months. And then to practice it, to your second part of your question, that's a little bit more challenging in the sense that you have to, for a tabletop, somebody has to come in and develop. What's the scenario? What are we going to test? What are we going to pretend how we got hacked? And there are people that do that. We can do it. PR people do it. That's not the point. The point is you got to engage probably with somebody who's had experience developing a tabletop exercise, and then you put one in. That's several more months just in the typical cadence of things. Can you do it quicker? Of course you can. But, as these things go, you're going to want to get a comfort level within the organization, have these people come together, develop the plan, and then, okay, let's test it. So in my experience, I would guess the average is at least 6 months from start to the first tabletop, maybe even 9 months, sometimes a year. It's not unusual. But, if you don't start, you never get there. So, again, thanks for that. Then just 2 seconds worth. Every state, except two, they don't have any response, reporting, but every state has got their own state law for data breach incident reporting. And we have a live tool here at Dorsey, so if something happens, we know exactly, once we find out the jurisdictions, the number of people that are in, we can get those notifications going. Sometimes you have to notify the Attorney General first, sometimes at the same time, sometimes later. But there's a fair amount of just fire drill once you have a breach. And in Tennessee right now, they're the most aggressive state. It's 2 weeks you have from the day you become aware of the breach on before you have to report it. And I will share with you that the forensic experts that come in and look at the servers, et cetera, they won't even talk to you for a week. I mean, they've got to come in, image the servers, and then go to work, and they'll tell you a week, this is kind of what it's looking like. So that's the timelines are getting extremely, extremely close. The New York Department of Financial Services just announced a draft regulation, 72 hours. 72 hours. I will tell you, forensic people, we can't do it. We can't tell you. Yes, Mary Jane. Okay.
Two quick questions. Yeah. Which two states don't have the law or the breach notification
yeah.
law, and what is the timeline in Minnesota?
Alabama and North Dakota do not have it. The timeline in Minnesota is reasonable. Reasonable. But there's a trick in Minnesota because if you determine that you've suffered a breach that would trigger notification for credit monitoring agencies, that's an accelerated time. So even though it's reasonable, there's a twist in Minnesota. I would say the average right now is about, typically expected to be 30 days. We got a letter, one of our clients from the Indiana Attorney General saying, their standard's reasonable. Why did it take you 40 days? Well, because we didn't know what we had to work with, honestly. But what we're seeing is an increasingly aggressive enforcement by state's attorneys general. They have staff, they want something to do. I'm being a little bit facetious here, but you know, you're gonna see the bar get raised on what's a reasonable period of time. Yes, Beck.
Is every business obligated to provide the notification?
The question for the audience was, is every business required to provide the notification? The short answer is yes. Some states will have thresholds. So if you have below a certain number of affected individuals, you won't trigger their reporting. Some states have one. New York has one. If you have one person in New York whose identity has been hacked, you have to report to New York. So that's part of our tool. We figure out, you know, we'll get, the first thing you do is figure out who's what jurisdictions are impacted, how many people in those jurisdictions, and then you run the tool and say, okay, we have to send to Indiana, but we don't have to send to Massachusetts. You also have to send to Massachusetts. But and California is very aggressive, as you might expect as well. Mary Kay, yes? So the question for the webinar is this a question that the company should be asking if they're doing business nationally across the U.S.? The short answer is it's not optional. I mean, you should know what data you collect from what jurisdiction out of the blocks, but typically you won't know that for sure until you've suffered an intrusion, because not all intrusions will trigger reporting obligations. Some states require that the intruder have gotten the information. Others say just if they had access to the information, so you don't need to show that it was exfiltrated. So the more nuanced response, Mary Kay, to your question is, if you are doing business in various jurisdictions in the U.S., the best practice would be to understand what's the triggering criteria for a breach notification in each of those jurisdictions. The challenge, quite bluntly, is unless you've got a lot of resources internally, it's really hard to keep track. We are fortunate here because we've got a team that we track every time legislation gets changed that could affect breach notifications. We know about it. We have advance warning. We build it into our tool. And major companies can do that. If you're not a major company, those kind of resources, I mean, you do the best you can, right? But you probably are going to want to double check to make sure you've got it right, because they're increasingly less and less forgiving on these things. So I should, this is the last slide. I'm not going to go into it. It's there for your, to kind of look at and say, all right, for our system, how do we want to have it organized? Again, it should be organic. This is not, okay, this is what it's got to look like. This is an example. Take a look at it, and you see the different dimensions of cyber risk management for oversight and responsibility. I hope I haven't cut these guys off too much. So I will stop now. There'll be time for questions at the end, and certainly we'll have opportunities after the formal presentation is over to talk further. So thank you very much. Joe?
Al.
Joe. Al. Al. Whatever. Sorry. Al. Sorry. I apologize.
No problem.
Joe was yesterday.
Right, I get that all the time. Not Joel, but I look like everybody's little brother, I think. Hello, everybody. Thanks to Bob from Dorsey and for the facilities, and to Mary Kay and Perry of AgriGulf for inviting Baker Tilly to join the conversation here. So the perspective that I've been asked to represent is the assessment perspective. We'll get into what that is. It's a little gray. But let's start, forming our thoughts around assessments and cybersecurity within food and agriculture. The Department of Homeland Security considers the food and agriculture sector one of the 16 critical infrastructure sectors, along others like nuclear and energy and communication and healthcare. I was surprised to learn this while I was preparing for today is that the I'm sure many of you know this better than I do, but the food and agriculture sector accounts for 1/5 of the nation's economic activity. That was pretty surprising to me, and as Bob was indicating, these attackers are criminals. They're who are part of criminal enterprises, right? They're in this to make money. Now, there's other types of attackers, and we'll get into that specifically for, agribusiness. But they're well-funded. They're sometimes funded by nation states. And so it is about making money. So they're going to go for the low-hanging fruit. So as I think some of the new attacks that we're seeing, and really, not that information security and cybersecurity, well, we call it cyber now, maybe that's why, so because of the increase in attacks, now we have to attach something, right, sexy to something that we should have been doing for 30 years. But the point being that as these attacks increase, the amount of revenue and the funding that these groups have is getting very difficult to counteract. So as financial services and some of these other industries that have been dealing with this for a long time batten down the hatches, they're going for the lower and lower hanging fruit. And if I were to put on my black hat, I wouldn't go after a large financial services group. I would go for auto dealerships and meat packing plants, because often they have the same banking information as well as the same consumer information as data becomes aggregated. So I think that's what we're starting to see. And farming isn't the Amish farms that we used to think of anymore, right? These are very high tech, and so the challenges of trying to feed, as Mary Kay said at the beginning, 9 billion people on the planet Earth by 2050. I mean, there's going to be maybe this isn't the right metaphor, but an arms race, right, to put, dollar bills on the end of those forks. So, we're going to start seeing innovation move faster, and as innovation moves faster, maybe we cut a few corners. Think about the technology that's being used. So, drones and robots, which are used essentially to increase productivity and sometimes for reducing injuries, both to crops and to employees and to animals. But these drones and robots, it's relatively new technology. I remember buying my kids' drones 5 years ago, and they were tiny little things, and now they're getting more and more affordable. And so these drones and robots and self-driving tractors, this is a part of the Internet of Things, as we all hear about, the IoT. Now the internet of everything, right? Everything seems to be getting, you know, an IP address, and if you have an IP address, you are a computer. I don't care if you're a drone, a robot, a sensor, you're on the internet, and anybody in the world can touch you, right? They can send different types of packets to you. You can put firewalls in place, but somebody has to manage those firewalls. So now the footprint, the attack surface, if you will, is increasing exponentially as we speak. And because this is relatively new technology, you know, they're being pushed to market incredibly fast. As Bob alluded to, you know, just this Friday and into the weekend, you know, Chinese manufactured DVRs and IP cameras were taken over by a botnet because it had a hard-coded username and password, and this Chinese manufacturer put out these devices, and they were white-labeled by, you know, tons and tons and tons of other manufacturers, and so they were propagated all over the world, and so because it had this one simple flaw that, again, it was hard-coded, it was impossible, they had to recall the devices to change these, if I remember correctly, they were able to take down Twitter and Netflix and you know, many, many other very popular websites by attacking our domain name structure, which is the core of the internet. So it's coming, right? We're starting to see that. We just saw it 3-4 days ago. So these tests and you know, looking at the how the armor is made up, that's happening. And you hear pundits talking about this, you know, cyber Pearl Harbor or whatever we're going to call it. But we're starting to see the signs for something similar that could take us down. I was just thinking about that. I traveled last week, and I thought, you know, if the internet was unavailable, I wouldn't, and if it happened in a moment's time, you couldn't board your plane, right? Because you've got, you know, who prints out a ticket anymore, right? You couldn't go to the kiosk. It would be a nightmare. So just by having new technology that's being adopted quickly for the purposes of productivity, if you know, nobody wants to slow, that's a challenge also with many of you that have worked in cybersecurity. Most people don't do cybersecurity for the right reasons, right? Because it's what we should always have been doing, right? It slows products down. It slows, you know, projects down. It adds revenue to projects. It hasn't really been adopted. It's always been a CapEx spend. It's been something that, you know, adds, you know, difficulty to putting out whatever you're trying to put out. We're seeing that now. So I don't know if it's going to have to be, you know, government enforcement, if it's going to have to be compliance initiatives, or if it's going to, you know, what we're hoping is that consumers will, you know, make their purchasing decisions based on, you know, cybersecurity and privacy being part of the transaction. So we're not seeing that yet, but because, especially in the United States, we're such a consumer-based economy, hopefully, you know, that will be one of those marketing things on some of these newer technologies. I digress. So so drones and robots and other technology related to agribusiness, RFID tags, which is related really to GPS tracking, satellites, all of that precision farming technology. The challenge with these specific technologies is that all of these sensors and technologies capture tons and tons of data, as Bob alluded to. But, you know, technology, as we all know, is great when it works. But machines fail, and machines often, if they don't fail, can hiccup. And so thinking about this from a farmer's perspective, a farm data perspective, dependency on all these sensors that are in your fields, in your barns, in your, you know, if any of those sensors do hiccup, particularly the use case I'm thinking about is if you have a farm and a sensor, you know, malfunctions, it could be a double-edged sword in some cases. And I think there is even some case precedents about this out there where imagine a farmer, you know, trying to monitor their pesticide use or their, you know, fertilizer limits, and some of these sensors malfunction. Imagine trying to prove, you know, in a court of law or with a protester or with a regulator that it was the sensor that, you know, indicated that this pesticide was sprayed into a body of water somewhere, right? And there's fines and regulations around that. I think because there's evidence, right? And we've got all this data that's being aggregated. You know, I think that's some of the challenges that we're seeing with even the again, what Bob brought up about the farm data principles. I think that's starting to shake out. But again, we're depending on so much technology, and as we aggregate that data, it can be a double-edged sword. So that was my point there. Around the challenges about specifically the data, again, is, and I think the agribusiness is rehearsed on, you know, protecting intellectual property with patents and even with physical security. But again, as data continues to grow and explode in farming and agriculture, you know, even this question of ownership, as we indicated, is getting blurred. So what if a farmer, let's say, leases his soil to another farmer? So who owns the data from that farm? Is it the farmer who's leasing, right? I'm sure this will all be shaken out in contracts, but it's a very, the challenge is both to the technology and then, of course, the data that technology generates. Okay, so now let's talk about the risks within agribusiness. This is probably, if everybody here hasn't been hit with this, they've at least seen it or heard somebody talk about availability attacks, specifically extortion malware or ransomware or cryptoware or scareware. I mean, this is evolving as we speak. This is probably, I would say, in my time, you know, 17 to 20 years doing this, has become an epidemic. Partly because they are using this as a nuisance attack, right? So if you're a farmer and somebody clicks on something and you get a pop-up and it says, we've encrypted all your data, we need half a Bitcoin, $300, right? Why wouldn't you just pay it? It's, you know, difficult to get Bitcoin, but we're starting to see community banks and credit unions aggregating Bitcoin specifically for the purposes of paying small businesses, helping them to pay off these attacks, which is a cycle, and because now you're continuing to fund these criminal enterprises. But if you're going to be down for 2 to 3 days because you don't have great backups, maybe it's easier to spend $300 to get back online, right? So this is a very difficult situation that is continuing to evolve. But mostly it's a challenge because it's a volume play, which is enabled by email, right? How much email does everybody here get? So because of the mechanism to deliver this, and because we're dealing with human beings, you know, that are fallible, and due to the human condition, they will click on certain things through, that's why social engineering works. So these availability attacks specifically to data are continuing to really be epidemic in proportions. And then, of course, there's technology breakdowns. Many of the same technologies that smart farming use are also used in, you know, other of these critical infrastructures. Think SCADA systems. So the same vulnerability that could hit a dam or a nuclear facility or a power grid have the same vulnerabilities that other legacy industrial control systems have. So, you know, you're only really one IP address away at, you know, in agribusiness with your sensors and some of your SCADA systems as a dam would be. And as we know, IP addresses on the internet are contiguous, right? They're one after another. So traditionally, these tools are just out there going through blocks. So if you happen to be the next one, you're going to be hit. We've got data breaches. I think we've talked about some of that. I mean, remember the conversation that we just had at the end of Bob's talk around, you know, what is a data breach? I think that's really where insurance, cybersecurity, professional services, and, you know, the legal profession collide around, you know, what is a breach? What jurisdiction are you in? How was, you know, is ransomware a reportable breach? nothing was really stolen. I was just social engineered into doing something, right? From the insurance perspective, if somebody sends me an email and they convince me to do an ACH transfer to the Bank of China, is that a breach? Well, they didn't really threaten me. I volunteered that data, or right, that ACH transaction. So it gets really muddy around what is an actual data breach, and specifically for farm data. You know, the type of data that I'm not going to talk about, some of this is traditional stuff that people have dealt with. And then, of course, there's activism, which is a little different than the majority of challenges we're seeing around ransomware. You know, many groups historically offline and on have made it their mission to disrupt the financial, the food and agriculture sector. Okay, so assessment options. As I indicated earlier, attack surface reduction is really how we're starting to talk about solutions to these problems. Because there's so many folks out there now, well-funded nation states and criminal enterprises that are looking to make money because it's working, right? Ransomware is working. Communities are stockpiling Bitcoin so they can pay off this. It's funding these enterprises. So, it's only emboldening more folks to be out there looking for these indicators of exposure. One of the solutions is through phishing simulations. So the majority of, almost 95 to 99% of ransomware attacks start with phishing emails. As we said, it's a targeted email that is uses social engineering techniques to take advantage of greed. You know, we're sending you a free gift card. People will click on that. And anyone who has an email address is already being tested weekly, if not daily. And so the approach that we take with our clients is to actually do these simulations on behalf of our clients so that they can get that immediate visceral. There's, in my experience, again, after 17 to 20 years, there's no better awareness training than sending a phishing email to an executive, having them click on that, viscerally experiencing, I just got duped, and then you give them 1 to 2 minutes of training around what they should have been looking for in that email. And it's what's the word? Imprinted, right? I mean, evolutionarily, to be embarrassed like that and to get feedback. So for your cyber bucks, there is no better way to spend it than to do some of these phishing simulations, especially with the amount of phishing attacks that are out there. Open source intelligence testing. This is a unique one for most people. Should I?
I just have a quick question.
Yes.
About what you just said. So is the CEO kept in the dark that you're doing simulation?
There's two approaches. You can do it black box, as you would, or you can forewarn people that this is something that's important. I've seen it both ways. It depends on what awareness training has already been accomplished. I mean, this is not a new thing, but it's the popular one now, right? Because it's working. And so, a lot of folks have already done some awareness training with their employees, for good or bad. And we can take that training and look at it and say, well, actually, you know, for example, a lot of times we'll look at people's acceptable use policies or awareness training that they have, and it'll say, don't click on a link in an email. Copy and paste it into your browser. Well, that's not really great advice, because we can actually test that, because there's different fonts that you can use. You can make an L look like a 1 just to mimic. So you're not really educating anybody, right? They could just blindly copy and paste it into a browser thinking that's the solution. But really what you should be saying is, take a look at that URL. Here's what you should be looking for that could make it look like it is being spoofed to a rogue website, right? So there's certain things like that that we can take a look at as, you know, what is already the baseline, and then how do we get it to the next level? So CEOs, for the executive suite in general, usually those are a little more targeted attacks. The first, kind of the level one attack would be to just send everybody the same misspelled email, right, that should... You're really trying to change behavior, right? It's okay to slow down, right? We all get 800 emails a day, but it's okay to slow down if something looks weird and just take a look at it. That's really the simple thing that we're trying to accomplish. Does that answer your question? Yeah, Oli.
Are you talking with employers about versus, I think in the past, a lot of employers have looked at it as they're going to punish you if you've done something wrong.
Right, right. Sorry, I've forgotten that people are on the phone. Sorry, I'll repeat the question. So we were just asked, are we helping employees to essentially report that they're getting these emails, right? And somehow escalate this, not just keeping security, I'm putting words in your mouth now, but you know, keeping that security within the employee base and giving them an opportunity and encourage, not punishing them, to send these emails on to support or to information security. Is that?
Yeah, or if they click on a link and they open the link, they go blank.
Right.
And they think, I may have done something wrong. I think oftentimes employers in the past have more or less punished the person,
right,
as opposed to,
okay,
encouraging them to report it.
All right. So we clarified the question. It's really, you know, the approach around if somebody clicks on a link and it's a PDF and suddenly it blows up, right? Traditionally, there could be an approach to be, they would be punished for something. Like, they did something wrong, right? I clicked on the wrong link. Aren't I stupid, right? I'm not going to say anything because I don't want to be embarrassed, right? Great question, because that's exactly what I think this simulation and these types of exercises does, is it raises the conversation, right? So that people can start to feel comfortable talking to their cube mate, right, or to IT. It's not this IT thing anymore. It's okay to ask those questions, right? But if your employers are having, if there is that culture of punishment, or, you know, we're the IT folks, right? We're the security guys, and, you know, we know so much more than all of you, and, you know, there's this feeling of punishment, that's not a very mature organization, and you're going to get duped into this kind of stuff constantly, right? In fact, I would say that the worst offenders are sales organizations, right? When we've done a lot of these phishing simulations, predominantly it's the sales organizations that are clicking on these things, because we always say, don't click on a link that you don't know, right, or that hasn't been sent to you. Well, these are sales folks. They're incented to take risks, right? To, that could have been a sales lead, you know, that I just got. So that's really where that kind of, you know, behavior change needs to happen the most, is where they feel like they're being, I'm trying to back into your question and answer it, is they feel like they're being punished, right, for not opening those emails because they could have just lost a sales lead, right? That's where I see that particular, it's not, you're going to get fired in pink slip because you, you know, you clicked on a link, unless it was obviously collusion or some kind of nefarious activity, but typically it's, you're right, it is, they feel punished, so they don't say anything. Sorry, am I going over? I feel like I've been talking for a while. Okay. right. So, one thing that a lot of folks don't consider is what I'm calling open source intelligence testing. And we're seeing our client base is becoming much more interested in this. Now, I've been doing these types of engagements for 10 years, open source intelligence testing. But because of the predominance of social media, and imagine this is everything beyond your perimeter. When we do these types of engagements, we don't send one packet to your firewall. This is, and I think Bob addressed it a little bit, is we're looking into the internet, right, beyond your firewall, for information that could potentially turn your company or your executives, you know, of your company, from a opportunistic target to a deterministic target. And you'd be very surprised, especially because of the amount of information that is volunteered out. Again, this isn't just, you know, the traditional vulnerability scanning where somebody's pointing their cannons at your firewall and looking for the little bits and pieces that they might be able to attack, or a vulnerability that wasn't patched. This is information that's being volunteered out into the internet. So, for example, you know, I've been on engagements where we've been able to reverse engineer essentially an entire company's enterprise infrastructure based on the recruiting emails that they have and the job boards that they post, because they're putting on there, we need these types of skills. So, and you would never know that I had been collecting that information if it wasn't as a part of an engagement. So there are warehouses of individuals that are doing this work in these nation states, and you know, you would never know it because they're not sending any packets to your firewall, right? They're querying information that's already out there. So this is, we're seeing a lot more of our clients being interested in this because, again, this is that it, those nuggets that are out there on the information on the internet that can be aggregated that turn you into a more targeted attack. Third-party risk management, I think we talked about that quite a bit. Standard cybersecurity assessments, I guess it'd be an opportunity to quickly talk about that. One thing I would say is that there's a new, relatively new assessment that, that is becoming very popular for a couple reasons. The NIST, the National Institute of Science and Technology, has created a cybersecurity framework. A lot of people call it a maturity framework. I think that's a little misleading, but the benefit, in I don't have the statistics, but there was a survey done of 300-400 organizations that are interested in this this assessment, and they're predicting that it's going to be 80% of adoption in the next 4 or 5 years. Don't quote me on that, but it's becoming much more popular because recently the Federal Trade Commission, you know, which is the government's consumer watchdog, has recently come out. You know, they've always had this Section 5 of the FTC Act around unfair and deceptive acts within commerce. And they've always said reasonable security, right? We hear this term, reasonable security. And they've even had enforcement actions, you know, ones in here in town, right, around you're not having reasonable security. But they never told you what reasonable security was. But now the FTC has come out probably within the last month and said they will accept, you know, this FTC, this NIST cybersecurity framework activity as an exercise in due care. Now, that doesn't say exactly what, you know, reasonable security is, but it's the best we're probably going to get. So I think that's helping the adoption. And the great thing about the NIST cybersecurity framework is that it's not a controls framework. It's activity-based. So important distinction there because it's a program assessment. It's not, you know, the same old control-based assessment that we're all used to. So if you haven't, take a look at that. Compliance assessments, I think we've gone probably not the most applicable here. But I will end on this comment around PCI DSS, high trust, you know, SOC 2s, SSA 16s, those compliance assessments that we're all familiar with. Bob is right in that vendor management is the new risk management, right? We've seen that again in this town where you know, clients have been breached due to their vendors. And really the reason that the PCI DSS exists is because it is the, you know, they're pushing compliance down. It's the acquiring banks pushing it down to their merchants. We're seeing that with high trust, where the large payers are pushing compliance requirements down to their to the providers. SOC 2, if you're a service provider, you're either providing that or asking, you know, if you're consume services, you're asking for those SOC 2s. So I think as Bob indicated, and sorry, Madeline, I would say Madeline if you had come first, probably more. But I think we're starting to see a trend where a lot more of these third-party requirements are being pushed onto service providers. That is all I have. And then I will introduce Madeline from Lockton, and she's going to follow up talking about the insurance perspective. Thank you.
All right, good morning. Thanks for being here. And to those on the phone, thanks for joining us. As they said, I'm Madeline Allen, and I am part of Lockton's cyber technology practice. So our focus is on cyber insurance, and as Mary Kay said, this is not something anyone ever wants to talk about. The insurance piece is when people typically go get coffee or go to the bathroom or something. So hopefully this won't be too painful. Wanted to start out just kind of reviewing some of the risks. We've talked a lot about most of these already this morning, but want to emphasize that cyber insurance is a risk transfer mechanism that goes beyond the protection of information or the protection of data. It goes to the protection of your networks, third parties' networks. It goes to, manufacturing equipment, farm equipment, anything that is potentially connected to some sort of system, some sort of network. It's all an exposure, and it's all potentially insurable. So, don't want to limit the discussion today to protected information or confidential information. So certainly employee data, farm information, whether it's seed formulas, chemical formulas, yield information, smart farming technology, we've talked a lot about that already, but drones, GPS, and combines and tractors. Also industrial controls. If your manufacturing systems are linked to your networks, if you use smart technology to control your process lines, things like that. Distribution and logistics. If you use a portal or an interactive system with your customers to get product in and out, all of that is potentially an exposure. And then the last two, bodily injury and property damage. As the Internet of Things only continues to expand, so does the risk of bodily injury and property damage associated with some sort of network attack, security attack. So we'll touch a little bit on those as the cyber insurance market as it relates to property damage and bodily injury is still very young and is certainly evolving, but is a slow evolving process. Okay, so I want to jump into what does a cyber insurance policy cover, but I want to caveat it with this list here on this page and on the next page is a list of available coverages. There's no standard cyber insurance policy. The markets are not conforming in any way. Things like a property policy, general liability policy, those are fairly standard. There are ISO forms. Everybody pretty much knows what's covered and what's not. So don't take this as a guarantee that every policy covers all of these exposures, and certainly there is there's a lot of variety in what's out there. So I encourage you, if you're looking at a policy, if you're thinking about buying one, if you already have one, read the policy and talk to your insurance broker, talk to your insurance carrier, because there are a lot of things we may talk about today that are potentially not covered or not covered adequately under your current policy or something that you're considering. So the first piece is network security, and this is coverage for things like claim expenses and damages coming from a network security attack. So if a virus is launched from your system into a third party system, and that third party sues you, whether it's that you send an email, that you have some sort of direct access into their system to deposit information, to retrieve information, and your access into their system gives them some sort of network security issue. Coverage here for the liability coming out of that. The other big piece of the policy, there are sort of two main coverage parts. The first is this network security and privacy liability piece. The other we'll get to at the bottom of this slide, but the privacy liability is just what it sounds. It's coverage for allegations that you were responsible for protecting some sort of information and you didn't do that. Whether it's employee information, like stuff you'd find on a W-2, if it's confidential corporate information of your clients, anything that you had a responsibility to protect and you didn't do so. Excuse me. The next one is privacy regulatory proceedings and fines. And cyber policies are a bit unusual in that you can actually get coverage for regulatory fines and penalties. In most policies, other lines of coverage, that's specifically excluded. Here, it's an available coverage. I will caution it's not always included. It's one of the things we sometimes see excluded. And it's often a sublimited coverage, which means that it's not up to, you don't have the full limit of the policy available. So certainly if you're looking at a policy, that's something to consider if you function in a highly regulated space. And what the coverage here is for is if you have a breach of protected information and some sort of regulatory agency comes in and does an investigation, whether it's the state attorney general, Bob talked a lot about state notification laws, whether it's the FTC, the FCC, the SEC, the OCR for some sort of HIPAA violation, any regulatory authority that does an investigation, finds that there's been some sort of violation of that regulation, and then levies fines and penalties. The coverage here is for those fines, as well as the cost of that investigation. The last bullet point here says PCI fines, and that's not really a regulatory scheme, so this is technically misclassified on my slide. PCI is payment card industry, and this the PCI, the payment card industry, regulates by contract businesses that accept credit card transactions. And so when you accept credit cards, depending on the level of credit card transactions that you have, you either self-certify that you're compliant with their standards, or you go through an actual certification process with an approved vendor who can give you that certification. And should you have a breach of credit card information, the payment card brands, based on your contract with them, are going to come back and they're going to fine you and find that you are out of compliance and that you need to pay X amount of fines. And those fines can get very high. We're typically seeing them run between $3 to $5 per card breached. So if you have a 10 card breach, that's not so bad. If you have a 4 million card breach, that gets really high. So coverage here, again, unusual because it's fines and penalties, but just keep in mind that that's not actually a regulatory scheme. That's more of a contractual scheme. But again, coverage is available. The next piece down, privacy event expense reimbursement, is the other big piece of the policy. So we've got the privacy and network security liability at the top. Here is the next big piece. We switch gears a little bit here because it's not a liability coverage. It's coverage for the insured's cost to respond to the breach. So it's things like providing notification to comply with the state notification laws. It's hiring an attorney to help you navigate which laws you've triggered, how you need to respond, how quickly you need to respond. It's providing credit monitoring, whether that's mandated by state law or you just want to do it because you are a nice company. It's things like setting up a call center. So if you had a breach of a lot of personal information, you don't necessarily want all of those folks calling your front desk, calling your general counsel. You want to have a dedicated call center set up so that folks can call and get information about what they need to do, how they're going to get the credit monitoring, what information was potentially exposed. And then the last big piece here is the public relations piece. And this, again, is often a sublimated coverage, so I encourage you to watch out for that in your policies. The coverage here would be to hire a PR firm to help you, one, deliver the message that you want to deliver to the public. Only send out the information you want to send out. Craft the message to help restore confidence in your company to protect information. I think we're good. Somebody was waving from the back of the room. So the next slide talks about what we'll call ancillary coverages on the policy. These are less standard, but certainly readily available in the market. The first is data or electronic information loss. It's also called data restoration. And it's coverage to recreate, restore, recollect information that's lost, damaged, destroyed as a result of some sort of network security attack. Here, it's coverage for your information as an insured that's lost. So your corporate information, your employee information. If the attack destroys a third party's information, that comes back up under the liability section that we talked about a minute ago. So this coverage almost functions like coverage on a property policy. You have some sort of issue that destroys your property. In this case, it's a cyber attack that destroys your data. And the coverage here pays you to recreate or to replace that damaged data. The next one also functions similarly to a property policy coverage. It's business interruption coverage. So it's coverage for loss of income as a result of some sort of computer attack or cyber-related peril. A really good example of this is if you have a manufacturing system that's connected to, that's run by a computer, you have an industrial control system that's very robust and advanced, and a virus gets in and it shuts it down, it locks up the manufacturing equipment, and you can't send products off the line. You can't process whatever it is that you process through your system, you can't run that, so you don't send that product out into the world, and you don't get income from that. Coverage is for that loss of income coming from your systems being shut down. And again, this is a first-party coverage. It pays for the insured's loss of income. Yes?
May I interrupt
just
for a moment? I'm going to give you a question.
Yeah.
Someone has to leave early, and I want to see that they get their question answered before they have to meet.
Okay, so the question is, both the state and federal government maintain a significant amount of farm, agribusiness, food company, data, permits, inspections, farm program eligibility, et cetera. Do the panelists have any perspectives on how prepared government agencies are as it relates to cybersecurity, and what recourse do farms businesses have if a government agency has a security breach? Okay, so the first part of the question was perspectives. Generally, and this will probably come as no surprise, government agencies are probably some of the least prepared to handle any sort of data breach. The FBI was subject to a breach recently. The IRS has been subject to several breaches, and the response has been less than ideal. I can't speak specifically to federal agencies or state agencies that hold agribusiness data or farm data, but I would have to imagine that it's similar. I don't have any reason to believe that it's any better. Anyone else on the panel? Are there microphones on over there? Okay.
Yeah, this is Bob. The only other thing that I would add is typically the federal government enjoys sovereign immunity, and they have to expressly waive it, so that if hypothetically your information is in the hands of the Department of Agriculture, and they it's breached and you suffer a loss, it would be for the most part, every situation would have to be looked at, but for the most part it's impossible to sue the federal government unless they've expressly waived their sovereign immunity. State governments, you may have a little bit more room there depending on the what the state did, how they did it, what commitments were made, but for the most part, I absolutely agree with what Madeline said. They are very ill-prepared. You know, the OPM breach was horrible. They took them forever to respond. They had to fire the response vendor. That's a great question, by the way. So I think that they are unprepared, and there's not much you can do if they get hacked. Other than that, I have no other good news.
Thank you for that uplifting comment. Go ahead.
So the question was, what can the farmer do? You know, that's a very good, I hadn't thought about this, but encryption, right? Basic stuff. So it seems to me that it wouldn't take a groundswell for those that provide information to government agencies to say, I'm going to give this to you in an encrypted format, and I'm going to limit the keys that you can access it, but then they would have to have not just the information itself hacked, but the keys to the encryption have to be hacked. And here I am playing IT person, but you know, it seems to me that there are some things they could do by way of encryption would be the easiest one. And you know, are you going to negotiate with the federal government? Probably not. But you might try that. The other thing, I mean, you can't ask for the return of your data after some period of time, and you know, we could probably get down this rabbit hole a long ways, so I won't do that. But I'd like to think about that some more, but for the most part, I wouldn't be terribly optimistic.
I was going to take Bob's encryption and raise him data de-identification. Probably new to the agri business, but very well known within the healthcare space. And essentially, it's you know, if you think about healthcare data versus farm data, there's definitely, I think, overlaps in that. What is the exact data attributes that need to be used? You know, what is the what's the scientific question that we're trying to ask by gathering that data, right? And I think that concept of data de-identification is going to trickle down, because there's probably some community-based statistics that they're looking for, but that doesn't need, you know, that doesn't, you know, require them to gather more individually identifiable data, whether it's their farm prescriptions or whether it's, you know, the farmer's data themselves. So I think that methodology of data de-identification, we'll probably hear a lot more of that.
I would say that philosophy is not limited to, you know, smaller farmers. It's anyone dealing with any organization with whom they have little bargaining power. You have to take steps to protect yourself, you know, and that starts with the encryption, that starts with the data identification, knowing where your data is, taking the steps to protect it, and then doing your due diligence before sending that data out, whether it's de-identifying information that doesn't serve, you know, the identification doesn't serve a purpose, whether it's limiting access to who sees that information, whether it's limiting the timeline. You know, if somebody doesn't need data from 3 years ago, don't send it. You know, turn off their access. So, and then, you know, obviously the last part, my shameless plug for insurance, protect yourself with the insurance policy. There's, you know, aside from having the coverage to, you know, to pay for the liability, to pay for the cost associated with it, there are some added benefits, and we'll get into those here in a second. There are some added benefits to having the insurance that can help you with that response when you feel like you don't know where to turn or you don't know what to do and your data's been exposed or your systems have been compromised. Any follow-up questions on, was that, I think that was Perry's question. Any follow-up questions? Yeah.
So you said that this logic would apply to any organization with little bargaining power. So would that go for, I had a question about member organizations and co-ops. So in terms of the association or the co-op's responsibility for their members?
Sure.
Does this situation apply to that?
You know, I think it does. I think when I said bargaining power, perhaps that wasn't the right term. You know, oftentimes when you're signing a contract and you're engaging someone's services, you don't have a lot of say in what that contract says. And, you know, if you are the buyer of those services, you're often beholden to what is in the contract and you don't have a lot of ability to change that. So I would just, you know, I think it... it behooves everyone to take responsibility for their information and starting from the beginning to make sure that they've taken the steps to protect that, even if they are able to get some recourse from, you know, the party who was responsible. You guys have anything to add on that one? Okay. All right, so we'll jump to the last insurance coverage, and that's cyber extortion. And I think both Bob and Al touched a little bit on this, but certainly ransomware, things like CryptoLocker, those are much more prevalent. We're seeing a lot. The initial targets were people like financial institutions and healthcare, but we're seeing it move beyond those. Those folks in those industries have been doing data security and privacy for a long time, and they're getting better at it, so it's becoming more difficult to hack those systems to steal that data. So they're turning to the softer targets, the agribusiness, the manufacturing, the smaller retailers, construction, industries like that, who perhaps have less security, less employee training, less risk management resources. And so we're certainly seeing an uptick in that. Cyber extortion coverage used to be kind of a throw-in on the policy. It was something that nobody really asked. The underwriters didn't ask questions. We didn't really ever see claims on it. And in the last year, it's probably been our most prevalent claim filing. Oftentimes, it's fairly small amounts that are being demanded, but you know, the costs aside from the actual extortion demand are perhaps the biggest risk or the biggest exposure. If it shuts down your manufacturing equipment and you can't send out your product, if it shuts down your ordering system and you can't accept orders, or your customer is going to go somewhere else to find the product that they need to fulfill their order. So here, obviously, the coverage is for the extortion demand and the cost associated with it, but it can also trigger other coverages under the policy, like the liability sections or the business interruption coverage. Okay, so we've talked a lot about what's covered under an insurance policy. I just want to quickly highlight a couple things that are not covered, so that there's no confusion. I put bodily injury and property damage on here and then recently caveated it with coming soon, because carriers are realizing and insurance professionals are realizing and customers are realizing that this is an exposure that needs to be addressed. It is although we've seen few actual claims, it's a very real exposure that a virus gets in and shuts down a system and causes property damage to that plant, or that somebody hacks a self-driving vehicle and causes it to crash, and there's bodily injury that results from that accident. So how do we address those? Right now, it's not well addressed in the insurance market. General liability policies don't want to cover cyber-related attacks. Cyber policies don't want to cover bodily injury and property damage. We kind of fall into a bit of a gray area. But it's something that several carriers are addressing, so stay tuned because it's an emerging exposure. The next one is reputational harm. We talked a little bit about business interruption coverage that covers the actual loss of income resulting from the systems being down. What it doesn't cover is customers who get upset or get concerned that you had some sort of breach and they leave. They go find another source for their product. They go find another business or business partner to be their vendor. And so outside of the actual loss of income from your systems being down, you lose general business and general harm to your reputation. There is a standalone coverage that can be purchased for that, but it is not part of a cyber policy. Next is patent infringement. And this is most of the time when I talk to people about patent infringement not being covered, we sort of gloss over it. In agribusiness, it's more prevalent because there are a lot of patents floating around, and there is not coverage under the cyber policy for any sort of allegation of patent infringement. If you're alleged to have infringed on a patent, if you allege that someone infringed on your patent, it's not covered under the cyber policy. Again, it's an available standalone coverage. It's very expensive, but it is out there. The next one is internal or in-house costs. The one thing the policies don't cover as far as breach response costs is paying your general counsel or your legal staff overtime to help draft the notice laws. It doesn't cover overtime for your copy room folks to print letters. If you want to pay your IT guys to do a little extra investigation, doesn't cover any of the in-house costs. You do need to go outside, seek outside vendors to help you with that response. And then the one piece I don't have on the slide, but after some discussion that I heard earlier, I wanted to mention this. There's been a lot of talk about social engineering, and there are sort of two areas of social engineering. One is deals with the theft of information. So somebody sends an email to one of your HR folks pretending to be the CFO who says, I want to see all W-2 information on our employees. Please send me their W-2s ASAP. And that information goes to the wrong people. That's covered under a cyber policy because it's the exposure of confidential information that got into the wrong hands. What is not covered is someone sending an email to one of your accounting folks saying, hey, I need you to wire this money today or we're going to lose this business. That is the transfer of funds, and that is not covered under a cyber policy. So it's an important distinction to draw between a cyber policy and what can be covered under a crime policy. Is the cyber policy is intended for the theft or the disclosure of information. The crime policy handles the theft or the disclosure of funds. And I will note, not all crime policies cover that, so check, because you'll need a social engineering endorsement. How am I on time? Okay. Okay. Yes. We'll do this last slide because these are kind of the interesting pieces. These are a couple real-life claim examples. One was a data center employee. I talked kind of about this a second ago. The CFO sent an email asking for all W-2 information. The HR employee sent a list of all of the information on 700 employees. Turned out it wasn't actually the CFO. That client did purchase a cyber policy. The policy did provide credit and identity monitoring to the employees. So far, there haven't been any lawsuits against the company, but the policy is ready and available if needed. The next one, and this is perhaps the most relevant example we have as far as property damage and potentially as it relates to the manufacturing industry. There was a steel mill or steel plant in Germany where the hackers accessed the industrial control system. They manipulated the controls that caused the shutoff controls in their blast furnace to become disabled, and it essentially melted the blast furnace as well as several other pieces of equipment in that facility, causing significant property damage as well as income loss because the plant was not able to function for a significant period of time. And then the last one, this is one of those crypto locker cyber extortion type events. A hospital client received an email. They opened it. It was launched with a virus that encrypted all their systems. shut down the hospital operations. They had to send patients elsewhere. They couldn't perform surgeries. Patients who were already admitted to the hospital had to be sent elsewhere. They paid about 13,000 Bitcoin to release the encryption key and returned operations. This happened back in April, late April, early May, and they're still not fully back up and running. They are continuing to find issues in their system that haven't been resolved, and they are not back up to where they needed to be. All right, the last couple of slides, this one is just on breach costs, and I'll leave you with this one, talking about the cost of a data breach, the potential cost per record for information that's exposed. The one thing I'll caution is, well, two things. One, don't take the cost per record and multiply it by the number of records you think you have. Your numbers will get really big, and that's not necessarily the right way to look at your exposure. And then the other thing is, when you're looking at these studies that talk about cost per record, I caution you to look at how that number is calculated. Here on this bottom one, it talks about the average claim payout per record was $956. That doesn't weigh any of the information depending on the number of records breached. There was, within this data, we know that there were several very small record count breaches that were that cost a lot. And so it's skewing this number. If you look at the data, when it's weighted appropriately, it comes out to more like $19 per record. So I would encourage you just to look at the math behind these reports and understand what's going into those. Okay.
So as the host, I exercised a prerogative and I asked Mary Kay if we could steal from some networking time so we could, I think you may have some more questions.
Yeah.
Because I'm kind of getting the sense of the room. I don't see anybody looking at their watch saying, can I leave now? So if it's okay, we'll go over a couple. I think it was terrific, and thank you for that. If I can have one quick question.
We're scheduled till 11:45, so we're not even stealing yet.
So for Madeline, for the people in this room and for the clients that I deal with, a couple things. There's a seems to be fairly spotty underwriting that goes on. There's no real clean way to do underwriting. It's sometimes they take a pretty good look, sometimes they don't. My question to you is this. For the people in this room, if we look forward to a day a year from now or 2 years from now or 3 years from now when the underwriting is a little more rigorous, right, what would you advise the people in this room to say, if you're going to be ready to get some more scrutiny by the underwriters, here's some things you should be thinking about doing.
Sure. So, I mean, I guess I would start with, as compared to underwriting for, say, property policy, where they come out and do building assessments and, you know, take a look at the fire protections and they're climbing on your roof and going down in your boiler rooms, the underwriting is very minimal. For anybody that's ever completed a cyber application, I can tell you, you probably don't think it's minimal because the application is rather extensive. That being said, the things that we're seeing underwriters ask more questions about now and that I think we'll continue to see more inquiry in are basic things like encryption. Are you encrypting information at rest? Are you encrypting information on mobile devices, whether it's laptops, cell phones, flash drives? How are you protecting that information? How are you training your employees? Are you educating them about things like social engineering, like putting away files when they leave for the day? It sounds basic, but if you leave a file on your desk and somebody walks out with it, one, that potentially triggers a cyber claim, even though it's a paper file. And two, that's an easy thing to do. Put it in the cabinet and walk away. Are you identifying your information? Do you know where your sensitive data is, and do you have increased controls in those areas? I think mobile devices, the protection of mobile devices, encryption, and identifying data and employee information are probably the things that we see the most scrutiny on. And then vendor relationships. How are you identifying the controls that your vendors have in place? What questions are you asking them, not just from a contract or an indemnity standpoint, but actually inquiring with them about the controls and the systems that they have in place, and thinking about, you know, if you had those controls in your own operations, would that be sufficient to protect the information? And do you think that those are sufficient when the information is being sent elsewhere?
Thank you. Great discussion. And we will move forward with some more questions. This one is for Madeline. Do you have a sense of what percentage of large companies have agribusiness cyber insurance, and what are the reasons for not getting insurance that you're hearing about for those who don't?
I answered this question yesterday. So as a general rule, I think the percentage of companies, large companies that buy cyber insurance is still fairly low. Based on our clients, I would say it's probably somewhere between 45 and 55% of large companies buy cyber insurance. The reason for, I would say in the agribusiness space, it's probably even less than that. One, the exposure is not as obvious. You know, people think of a healthcare or a retailer or a financial institution as having a lot of information that needs to be protected. They don't necessarily see the exposure for somebody like a manufacturer or a farm operation, transportation, logistics, that kind of thing. I think some of the other reasons, there is still an idea that we have really good IT systems and we are invincible. You know, we won't be hacked because our systems are just that good. And unfortunately, that's not the way of the world. As our systems get better, the hackers get better too, and they tend to be one step ahead of us. So, you know, for instance, in retail right now, the end-to-end encryption, the installation of chip and PIN, those are huge steps in the right direction, but I think it's only a matter of time before those become hackable, and we'll be looking for the next best solution. So, you know, I think a bit of not having the fund or not knowing where to invest the funds. You have a limited amount of funds to dedicate to this, and so do we put it towards the insurance piece? Do we put it towards the controls piece? And how do we divide that up? You know, we're not really sure that our risk is there. So I think at this point, it's, you know, it's a lot about education to companies sort of outside of those traditional risk classes that the exposure is there. And what the coverage can do.
Okay. As a follow-up to that, do you have any examples, and this is for any of the panelists, do you have any examples of companies who have chosen not to get cyber insurance and regretted that? Like their reasons for why not didn't pan out?
I can tell you we have a large health system who has, to date, has chosen not to buy coverage. They've had several breaches, which I think have gotten more expensive than they anticipated. They're also running into some contractual issues where they're having requirements in their contracts that they have cyber insurance, and they've been, until recently, fairly successful in getting those pushed back or you know, saying that they were self-insuring the risk. That's not a solution for much longer. They're getting a lot of pushback from the people that they're working with, the people they're signing contracts with, who are saying, no, you actually need to buy the insurance. So I think it's gonna become a bigger issue as people become more savvy to the risk.
I'm gonna change streams just a little bit. What are the cybersecurity aspects of a disgruntled employee with a thumb drive? Is this an insured risk?
Yes, it is an insured risk. This is sort of, I read an article this morning about a disgruntled employee who poured cleaner into a coffee pot, and I feel like a disgruntled employee with a thumb drive is sort of the next, you know, is sort of the new pouring cleaner into a coffee pot kind of thing. But it is an insurable risk. I will, again, caveat that it is not covered by all insurance policies, so certainly make sure that your policy includes employee bad actors. There are a lot of, you know, somebody walks out with that flash drive and they can, you know, send the information out on the internet. We had a claim recently where a client obtained a bunch of personal information on several other employees, sold it to her sister, who then posted all the information on Facebook. There's a lot you can do with information on people. There's a lot you can do with information on corporations that potentially has dire consequences. And in the cyber insurance world, there's no difference between whether the bad actor is, you know, somebody hacking from a foreign country or your employee.
I've got a question for Madeline.
Yeah.
Based on that, what about, you know, an employee who uses, you know, competitive information and they've signed a non-compete, right? And they take that information, I mean, would insurance cover those claims against suing that person for competitive information? I mean, that's what I think of an internal bad actor. It's, you know, it's stealing competitive information.
So that we walk a fine line there. It depends on how the information is classified, whether it's confidential corporate information of a third party that they are using, that they're using inappropriately. So let's say that you, you know, Baker Tilly, you hire someone, they bring information with them from their old employer, mm-hmm. and that old employer sues you. It's gonna be questionable there. That's a bit of a gray area. It depends on how the information is compromised.
Is that because they would sue the person, not the corporation?
No, the employees are considered insureds under the policy, okay. As long as they are not the bad actor. So in that case, there's not going to be coverage for that employee. But that doesn't disclaim coverage for the company should they be brought into the suit as well.
Okay.
Another reason for good, strong employee engagement programs. Can you speak to any, and this is for any of you, can you speak about any agriculture sector specific cyber attacks? What were the threat actors after? Specific agricultural.
I don't know if this is directly cyber, but I know, you know, the seed wars and that's going on, and there was that, you know, expat, or I think he was actually a Chinese national, who was a H-1B visa employee of, I think, DuPont, who was smuggling in napkins and Orville Redenbacher boxes, you know. They caught him, somebody caught him digging through a field in Iowa, and they were trying to export that through Canada and through the United States. So, I mean, this is more of a physical thing, but I'm assuming that there was some, you know, reconnaissance that was done. I think he got 5 years, 10 years in prison, you know, national secrets. I mean, they were considering this. So, you know, if you can't, you know, I love this term. I don't think it's a new term, but the kleptocracy, right? Have you heard that term around China and Russia and some of these others? And so, you know, I guess the definition would be leading by, you know, thievery. I think we're starting to see more of that. Cyber, I don't have any specific examples that come to mind. Bob, maybe?
One that I know that has happened is the social engineering on the W-2s. I know that the ag sector got hit with that like anybody else. It wasn't unique to the ag sector, but I would echo what Al said about, you know, when we talk to the FBI, they are very candid about the approach of certain nation states, that they think if they can come and steal your trade secrets, steal your agricultural information that would be very valuable because you haven't protected it well enough, they don't view that really as even criminal. It's like if it's important to you, you should protect it. And if you're leaving it unprotected, I can go get it, and I don't feel that I'm really doing anything wrong. It's a culturally a different approach, but they will share that there's no threshold that some of these nation states feel they are crossing by doing that. And I would guess that, to the point you made earlier, Mary Kay, about the number of people that have to be fed, that's going to be done through technological advances, and major investments have been made to get those technological advances. Other countries have not made those investments, and they're going to steal them.
Okay. That's not a pretty picture. Another insurance question, but again, many of you may have an answer to this. What has been the insurance industry loss experience specifically for agribusinesses and cyber malicious attacks? If I got that right.
I would echo what Bob said a minute ago about cyber extortion being probably, or the social engineering being what we see in the agribusiness space right now as the primary claim scenario. And that certainly is not isolated to agribusiness. As far as claims experience outside of that, for agribusiness, I don't know that I've seen any specifically. Generally, the claims, we're seeing an increase in claims. You know, they're moving outside of their traditional risk spaces into areas that are less well prepared and are softer targets. And, you know, I think there's, I don't know if this is where you were going, whoever it was with your question, but there is a bit of a notion in the cyber insurance world that the policies are doing what they can to not pay claims. And I would tell you that we're seeing the opposite of that. We're seeing carriers be very readily available and wanting, well, not wanting, but readily able and willing to pay claims. The policies are paying out, and the coverage is there when it's needed.
Adding to that, if I could, what I'm hearing, just totally anecdotally, but it's what I hear, it's a soft market. The insurance market right now is a soft market. Cyber is a growth area. It gets premiums in the door. And I think and I'd love for you to comment on this, Madeline, if you can, that the trend is companies are very eager to place coverage. The premiums are very competitive, and right now, unless it's catastrophic claims, they'll pay the claims because they don't want a black eye in an industry that's very competitive right now. So my again, very limited anecdotal experience is that the companies are eager to get the business.
I would agree with that. We went through a swing in 2014 and early 2015 where we were feeling the effects of several big breaches, Target, Home Depot, Anthem, and they were hitting the insurance carriers who, although, you know, a lot of our clients and a lot of you all wouldn't fall into the retailer, healthcare, financial institution, it's the same insurance companies insuring your risks as would be as were on those big towers. And so we felt a hardening in the market, and it was harder to find coverage at competitive premiums in 2014 and early 2015. Knock on wood, we've gone several months now without a big breach. We thought Yahoo might be the next big one, but for whatever reason, it has not hit the insurance market. There's been, I don't know if they're self-insuring or what the reason is, but it has not hit the carriers like these other ones did, and we did not feel the impact of it in premiums at all. So right now we are certainly in a downward swing as far as rates go, and I think we will continue to be that way as new capacity enters the market. You know, I would have told you 3 years ago there were probably 20 or 25 insurance carriers who really had competitive products. I would tell you now there are probably closer to 50 or 55. There are a lot of companies who are seeing some money in this and who want to get into the market. And so it's just a matter of, you know, how quickly can they get their form ready and how quickly can they become competitive.
I am noticing the time. We are over and lunch is in the back of the room. There's three questions and then we'll wrap it up after that. In addition to the farmer privacy and security principles, are there other farmer or agricultural sector specific regulations or guidance?
Not that I am aware of. Sector specific, no. You will, I think Al mentioned the NIST standards. I do think we're gravitating toward them because they're fairly malleable for different industry sectors. So that's where I would look. But those are essentially voluntary. Now, as we've talked, we will have a different discussion in a year or two at the most. We're going to see less and less voluntary and more mandatory. Even if it's mandatory that you're aspiring to comply with NIST, but I'm not from a sector specific in the ag area. No, I'm not seeing it.
I would agree with that.
I think what's happening, especially with the farm data and privacy stuff, my understanding, and I'm not a lawyer, I'll count on Bob, but essentially, these consortiums are getting together in these industry groups to put together some principles so that contracts can be written to them. And I think that's kind of that's usually what you see first is sectorally, a consortium will get together, put principles together for good or bad, and then they have some leverage when there is some standard or regulation that comes.
Well, you almost took the next question out of my mouth. So do you see a need for formal regulations or protections that companies should be pushing for, you know, to get ahead of this? And would you feel that your answer just now, Al, fits into that, that some of that's happening through these sector principles?
Yeah, and I think that's traditionally you typically see that. Most corporations would like to, I mean, I've also had it explained that, you know, there's a political climate as well. I mean, outside of the craziness that's going on now, where even the FTC, who's now become kind of the enforcement arm for consumer issues, partly because nothing can get passed in Congress politically. So if that flips, sometimes you'll see laws and rules being passed, and then the FTC can kind of lower their enforcement arm. So there's a dynamic even politically and governmentally and regulatory, you know, that is we have to kind of surf, for lack of a better way to explain it. But I do think that I like what's happening with a third-party risk management kind of way that it's being adjusted, where contractually, you know, there's an obligation where, you know, an acquiring bank has a relationship with a merchant or a service provider, you know, can do their due diligence. I mean, I think that's the market. It's a self-regulatory market, I think, is probably the most successful.
So do you anticipate, much like the food value chain, how the consumer, the grocery stores, they're pushing it up that will only purchase from you if it's a sustainable product, so it's forcing companies to change? Do you see a similar dynamic?
I hope so. I think that was kind of the first hand that was played with these principles, was the farmer saying, you know, they wanted to, farmers own the data, all right? That was the big, first, you know, that was the controversial part of that. And really that was to force it up to, you know, the large data aggregators to say, you can have this data, but it's our data, right? If you make decisions contractually, they wanted to be able to. So again, I think that was the first step of a self-regulatory initiative. And I hope it goes that way. I think that's when things are most successful.
Okay. Are there any good list of resources that if people wanted to stay abreast on these issues, just to keep their finger on the pulse, that we could suggest for our attendees, or that we could send out, or places they could go to find, other than the three of you, of course?
For ag specific, you know, the group, I can't remember, the consortium, the farm, I've went out there since this kind of came up, and it was a controversial thing a year and a half, 2 years ago. And I think because of that, maybe their site hits, you know, not just for me, but everybody, right, are gaining. And I think they've got some great, the Farm Bureau Association, I think. I don't know, some other folks may know, but we could find that. Is it on here?
Yeah. I mean, honestly, I think that if you just Google privacy, give me 1 second now.
Sorry.
Privacy and security principles for farm data or something, that will get you probably what you need in a real-time basis. There's a ton of industry data out there and on data security, cybersecurity, privacy, that is not unique to the agricultural sector, and it could overwhelm you. But my gut would say, you know, search, you know, farm data security in Google, and you'll see what's happening on a fairly regular basis. If there is a dedicated news feed or development feed on that topic, honestly, I think I would know about it, and I don't think there is one.
I think the group that this came from was the American Farm Bureau Federation, AFBF, if memory serves me right.
You guys are providing me with just great transition points. So speaking of Google, you will all receive an email from Mary Kay Delvo at agrigrowth.org this afternoon with a survey about today's gathering, and it will come. There will be a Google link for. So we're going to do it in a Google Google Forms. So trust that. I'm sending that to you this afternoon. You can expect it's coming since we're talking about what to watch for and what not
to
watch for.
It'll ask you for your passwords. And,
yes, we just need a little information from you. But I hope you found this to be a useful morning and that you gained some information, some resources, and are thinking about this in new ways and thinking of more questions. We had great questions from the audience. Thank you. That's what really makes this an informative use of time from my perspective. So we have lunch in the back of the room, and you're just free to help yourself and network, and please do fill out that survey when you get it today. Thank you.